With COVID-19 closing the opera house and delaying the Met's opening night, I thought I'd do a little retrospective on the history of the old Metropolitan Opera House. I'll start at the beginning and go era by era. Each video will be interspersed with the recordings of opera stars of the era, along with my own drawings. When I sense that there are too many recordings to cover one era in 15 to 30 minutes, I'll go season by season instead. I got hooked into opera when I first heard Enrico Caruso's recordings of excerpts from Bizet's Carmen and Verdi's Aida in their original 78 RPM form when I was about 12. Now, I've been interested in the old Met at least since 2013. However, I've been delaying this retrospective for too long. And now that I'm staying indoors, I'm not holding back now. Let's do this thing. And where to start but the very beginning? The Metropolitan Opera Company in New York was founded in the early 1880s after some nouveau riche were unable to obtain box seats at the Academy of Music. The Old Met, or the Opera House on Broadway and 39th Street, opened on October 22, 1883. For perspective, 1883 was also the year the Brooklyn Bridge was completed, and the Statue of Liberty had even been shipped from Paris in pieces. Was waiting to rise in glory. The Old Met's personification is a male who, in the ensuing decades to come, grows up and ages like a human. His name is Mark Edward Tristan, and his initials appropriately spell Met. The Old Met's birth, October 22, 1883, was announced with a new production of Gounod's opera, Faust. Stars were Italian tenor Italo Campanini as Faust, and Swedish soprano Christine Nilsson as Marguerite. And contrary to what the sound excerpt may suggest, it was sung in Italian, which was the preferred style at the time. Anything from Bizet's Carmen to Wagner's Lohengrin was also sung in Italian. For a youthful Polish coloratura soprano named Marcella Sembrich, this was good news. When the Old Met was only 2 days old, on October 24th, she made her Met debut in Donizetti's Lucia di Lammermoor. Thank you. fortunate that most of the stars this initial season left no recordings of their work. In fact, it seems that of all the first season singers, only Marcella Sembrich left any recordings at all. To be specific, according to the discography of American Historical Recordings, she issued 52 recordings, almost all for RCA Victor. Among the roles Miss Sembrich sang during that first season were Elvira and Bellini's I Puritani. In Verdi's La Traviata. Amina in Bellini's La Sonnambula. Thank you. Gilda in Verdi's Rigoletto. Rosina in Rossini's The Barber of Seville. And Zerlina in Mozart's Don Giovanni. Only the operas that were meant to be sung in Italian. In all, Marcella Sembrich sang 55 performances, including tour performances, during her first season alone. As the rest of the stars of that inaugural 1883-84 season, their voices may very well be lost to the sands of time. Although the phonograph had been patented by Thomas Edison only 6 years before, it was seen largely as a novelty. And most of the big-name opera stars didn't think it would be a good idea to record their voices. Even Marcella Sembrich didn't cut her first records until 1903. So we're missing many important milestones. Nothing major, really. Just Christine Nilsson's Jules song, and Giuseppe Cashman's Il Ballet, and Roberto Stagno's La Donna Immobile, and Cello e Mar, and Giuseppe Del Puente's Torero song. Not to mention Italo Campanini as Faust or Lohengrin, Giuseppe Cashman as Don Giovanni, and Zelia Trebelli as Carmen. But all good things must come to an end. Throughout the inaugural season, production after opulent production cost general manager Henry E. Abbey a crap ton of money, since he not only had to pay for his singers, but also for their costumes, which had been designed by Wirtha Paris. It is said that by April of 1884, Abbey suffered a deficit of nearly $500,000. As a result of the deficits, Abbey withdrew as general manager, with no intentions of returning for a second season. Baby Marky Tristan, later to be called the Old Meth, was only 6 months old at the time, and he would live to be 82. But it already looked like he, along with the Metropolitan Opera itself, wouldn't even live to the age of one. To find out what happens next, please wait for the next video, because this may take me a lot of research to do.